We have this haze that's been going over our sky because there are wildfires going on in Canada, and that's a long ways away. That is a long, long ways away. But what's happened is the smoke from these wildfires in Canada has been coming down, and they give this haze that you can't really see very well, but it mixes with the clouds that we have here, and the sun is this weird shade of red, and so is the moon. So we've been having this strange shade of coloring from the wildfires. I feel really bad for the people in Canada having to go through that, but boy, it just makes for a beautiful morning out here. I guess that's the best I can make out of a bad situation, is that the mornings are beautiful. So the clouds are over there. I thought, ooh, good time to get out here because it's actually almost cold. Yeah, it's July and it's almost cold this morning. I think that's kind of a good thing because the mosquitoes, yeah, I know, I already fed you. The mosquitoes are still asleep. I just fed them. I fed the chickens, but they want to be outside because they saw me open up the shed, and the goats love jumping on everything in the shed. Bucky found my diatomaceous earth the other day. Diatomaceous earth, for those of you who don't know what this stuff is, it's a wonderful thing. It's this powderized stuff, and it's made from prehistoric sea creatures or something like that, like a little single-celled or whatever it is. It's kind of like a crushed limestone in a way, all right? There's a technical explanation for it, but I just don't feel like it this morning. I only had one cup of coffee. I have to get out here bright and early before the sun comes up to get my stuff done. Otherwise, when the sun hits, the humidity hits, the warmth hits, the mosquitoes come off the plants, and I turn into a pincushion. But doors were open to the shed the other day because it rained, and a little bit of water got in there and got the floors wet, so I was drying it out. And I forgot that Bucky likes buckets. Yeah, Bucky likes buckets. I know that sounds really ridiculous, but it's true. And Bucky always jumps into this bucket because this is what I bring the food in. So he went into the shed, and he jumped into the bucket that's in there, and that bucket is full of diatomaceous earth, which is basically the consistency of flour. Yeah, and so he is white as a ghost, and he's full of this stuff, and he comes walking out with this look on his face like, oh my God, my world just exploded. Well, you big stupid, don't jump into buckets that you don't know what's in there. But it's feeding time today, and I mentioned, I think, in a couple episodes ago that I do have to feed my garden, and what I feed my garden is compost initially, but as maintenance, I use compost tea. And I wanted to go over that because some folks don't, they haven't seen all my episodes, so I thought I'd go over this again this year to show you how I keep my plants healthy and productive. What I do is, of course, I put compost into the soil, and that's a good feeder, but the compost doesn't last forever. And so to keep them going and for a maintenance or for a boost, I use what's called compost tea. Now, the mainstream compost tea is this stuff that's made with molasses. Well, first you use like water, a little bit of compost, some molasses, and you put an aquarium bubbler down at the bottom, and you add all kinds of other weird Frankensteinian stuff into there, and you got this concoction going. And what that does, and it's a useful product from what I heard. I don't use it, but from what I heard, it's a useful product. What it does is it promotes the bacterial growth in the liquid, and the bacteria that's in your soil is what turns food into a usable substance for your roots. It's the middleman. Yeah, and so this, the compost tea that people talk about making, aerated compost tea, that is making more and more bacteria to put into your soil. I really, now, like I said, I'm gonna do the disclaimer right off the bat. Yeah, it's a useful thing, but I don't feel that it's really that useful for me because I got a lot of beneficial bacteria already in there. And if you feed them, they're gonna do what bacteria do. They're gonna get together and they're gonna procreate, you know? That's what happens when you feed something good, like rabbits. You feed them good in your yard. You can't get rid of those rabbits because they know that the food's available. They're going to make more rabbits. And that's the same thing with the bacteria. You don't need a whole lot of bacteria in your garden because once you feed them, you're going to have more bacteria than you can swing a bat at. So the bacteria is not the thing I need to add to there. What I need to add is nutrition for those bacteria to eat in order for them to feed the plants. That's where my compost tea comes in. And it's not just mine. This is an older method than the brewed compost tea. This one, it goes back centuries, and it's called steeped compost tea. All steeped compost tea is, and by the way, it's a lot less effort, and it's a totally different kind of tea. They really shouldn't call them both teas because they're not the same thing at all. Whereas the brewed tea makes bacteria, this is a nutrient extraction, and that's all it is. You put the tea in there, you add the water, you stir it around, you let it set, and it takes all the goodness that's in your compost and turns it into a liquid form so that you can pour it and spread it out all over the garden more evenly. So whereas normally you have a handful of compost. Yeah, that isn't going to go very far in your garden, right? I mean, you can't spread it out very far. You can turn that handful of compost into 5 gallons of tea, and that 5 gallons of tea is going to go a lot farther around your garden and feed a lot more square footage. So it's a very useful thing to have. Now, I'm going to show you how to make the compost tea. It's very, very simple, and I'm going to show you how to use the compost tea. It's even more simple. This is my compost pile, and boy, is it swarming with gnats. You know, when you're making compost, it doesn't really matter what kind of insects get into it, because like I mentioned before, it doesn't matter because they're going to do whatever they do. They're going to either eat the compost and break it down even more, or they're out there to eat other insects that are in your compost. So they have their own thing going on. It has nothing to do with you, has nothing to do with your garden. Now, if you have snakes in there, maybe it has a little bit more to do with you, but generally snakes will leave if you mess up the compost and keep moving it around. Mice and snakes, they don't like to be disturbed. So if you keep moving your compost, eventually, usually they will leave. But this compost pile is still in the process of breaking down. This is made from chicken manure and grass, mowed grass from my yard, dried grass. I throw it in my compost pile. Beautiful, dark, rich stuff, but it's not done breaking down. It still has about maybe a couple more weeks to go, so I can't use this stuff. I make my own compost, but you can also buy your own compost, and there's no shame in that game. You can buy bagged compost, or you can buy bagged composted manure. Now, manure, of course, is going to be a lot richer than their bagged compost, because from what I've seen and from what I've experienced of bagged compost, it's kind of like buying like store-bought veggies, like store-bought tomatoes. Store-bought tomatoes have no flavor at all. It makes you wonder why people even grow those stupid things. When you compare a store-bought tomato to a homegrown tomato, there is no comparison whatsoever. Same thing with eggs. You know, you got store-bought eggs, they're good. Homegrown eggs are infinitely better. Same thing with compost. There, I've never seen a bagged or mass-produced compost that could hold a candle to even mediocre homemade compost, because we add more good stuff to it. Whereas with commercial compost, they're putting in the least amount that they can to make the most amount of volume. So the compost that you get in bags really is kind of empty. So you're gonna have to use a lot more of that for your compost tea or for your compost for your garden. Composted manure is a little bit richer. So if you can find that, I would definitely suggest using that. Now, what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna head over here and come on over. This is my compost. It's beautiful, it's dark, it's sticky, it's rich, it's totally broken down. Even though you see little pieces of stuff in there, that doesn't mean anything. People will tell you that finished compost looks and smells like soil. No, not so, folks. Most compost does not look like soil, unless, of course, it was made out of really, really, really fine things to begin with, and this is not. This is made with mowed grass, which has little pieces of sticks and leaves and all kinds of stuff in it, so it's not going to look perfect. Don't know what that, oh yeah, that's a stick. Okay, but even though it has that stuff in it, it's still broken down. Now, down here, look at this. It looks like oil, doesn't it? Or really, really dark coffee. This is a mistake. The technical term for this is, it's a mistake. What happened is I put a lid on this. Once you finish your compost, you put it in a container, you might want to put a loose lid on it, because if you're like me and you have a lot of rain coming in, and you forget to put the lid on, a lot of rain gets in there, and now this container of compost weighs 2 tons, and I can't move it anywhere. I wanted to get it by the garden. I couldn't budge this thing. And it filled with water. Now, what's going to happen is this is going to start really smelling like cow poop really bad, because it's going to start fermenting with lack of oxygen at the bottom because it's all compressed, it's got the moisture and stuff. Doesn't matter. It's still good stuff. That's called anaerobic, when there's a lack of oxygen. And you may hear that anaerobic bacteria is going to be really bad. It could hurt you. Throw that compost out. No, 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 no. It doesn't matter, because once it's brought into, I call it brought into the light, brought into an oxygenated environment like this sludge right down here. All right, I just brought it out into the oxygen. Once this is brought out into an oxygenated environment, the anaerobic bacteria start to die because they cannot survive in an environment with a lot of oxygen. The oxygenated bacteria, which is called aerobic bacteria, they are the stronger, and they will survive, and they will start taking over this piece of compost here if it's put into an oxygenated environment. So don't worry about stinky compost or anything like that. It's not going to hurt your garden. Your garden likes a lot of weird, gross, stinky stuff. Let me tell you something. All those good veggies, you don't want to know what's going on in that soil, because it is not pretty. Now, the measurements that I use for my compost are very simple. I take one heaping handful, and normally I would just shove my hand in there and do that, but you just saw how disgusting this is. And there's a limit to how gross I'm going to be, so I'm not shoving my fist into this gross mess. So I got my little Barbie shovel here. One heaping handful of compost per 5 gallons, per 5 gallon bucket is exactly what you need. I'm going to add 5 gallons of liquid to this, and it's going to make 5 gallons of compost tea. Now, if you have bagged compost or composted manure, I would suggest about twice as much as this, because like I said, homemade is always better than store-bought. In almost everything that you get. So you want to use twice as much. If you got bagged compost, take 2 heaping handfuls, throw it in there, you're all set to go. Same thing with the compost and manure. The weird thing about compost, actually the good thing about compost, is you can never overdose on it. No matter how, like if you're making compost tea and you think you made it too strong, you think, oh, is that going to hurt my plants? No, actually it will not. That is the cool thing about using compost tea. If you use almost any kind of fertilizers, you can overdose your plants on fertilizers and kill them. With compost tea, you cannot. That is the wonderful thing. If you add too much, oh well, it's a good thing. You know, your plants are going to love it, and they're not going to die. So don't worry about making your compost tea too strong. And also, before I get over there, I want to tell you about this. You want to make sure that you fill this up with water and let it set about 24 hours. That gives it a chance to get all the good stuff out of the compost and make a really good tea. And that's all you have to do. That's why this compost tea is such a wonderful thing. All you do is you throw in the compost, add the water, let it set. You're all set to go. Okay, now let's go on over there. I want to show you. I'm not going to make compost tea here because I already have some made up. I just wanted to show you the compost and the bucket and then the amounts. But I'm going to show you because I make it in bulk. I mean, 5 gallons of compost isn't going to go very far with me. So I make it in a 35-gallon tub. I want to show you what finished compost looks like. Come on over here. I had this old trash can in my basement, and I had no use for it. So I brought it outside, and I store it in the shed. And every year, I use this to make my compost tea. It's a wonderful thing because there's a lid for it. So if it's going to be raining and I don't want this to fill up with water and overflow, I just throw the lid on. Otherwise, leave your compost tea uncovered. It really doesn't need to be covered. And you don't have to put an aerator in this. You don't have to do anything. All you have to do is use it up as quickly as you can. So only make as much tea as you're going to be using, like say in a few days. And then every few days you make some more. Don't make enough to last you all summer, because you really don't want this stuff sitting around, because things are going to happen. You're going to get mosquitoes. They're going to lay eggs in it. Yeah, mosquitoes will lay eggs in it. Weird bugs will fall into it. Every now and then a bird may try and land it, and then you'll find a dead bird. And you don't really want to find that in your compost tea. It's really kind of sad in a way. Okay, but anyway, take a look at, what is that? I don't know what that is. Into the tea it goes. This compost tea I made about 2 days ago. I was going to use it the day after I made it, but we had some heavy rains yesterday and I got about another inch of water in here. So what I do before I use my tea is I take a bucket and I just move it around. That just gets it all mixed up. That's all it's for. Now, all you do, now look at this, see how it's going in there, and it's nice and dark. It's kind of like muddy water. That's what it looks like. And your compost tea should look like coffee or muddy water. That's what it should look like. If it looks really light and you can see through it really easy, you might want to make it a little bit more condensed. But this is what compost tea is. It's nothing more than a nutrient extract in liquid form that you pour around the base of your plants. It feeds the soil, that feeds the roots of the plants, that feeds your plants. Now, for feeding large areas like the asparagus patch and just pouring it on a wide area, I would use a bucket like this, or for around the base of the tomatoes and the sunflowers, definitely a bucket like this. But for getting in around delicate stuff like smaller plants or onions, I use a smaller container. Now, if you have a watering can, that's wonderful. But the only watering can I have is that ridiculous Dreamhouse Barbie little blue one that I have in the Voodoo Garden. And that's not a good one because my compost tea, I don't filter it. The compost that I use for this is settled at the bottom. So when I'm mixing it up with the water, every now and then you get a little piece of stick or a leaf or something in here. That's okay, because if that goes in here, that's fine because the soil is going to eat that up too. But it's not good for a watering can because I always had those ridiculous small spouts and things get plugged up in there. And I found that out the hard way. So what I do, I have this old Kool-Aid container that I had in the house that I don't need anymore, and I just use this, and I just water the plants with it. And just gently pour it around the plants. Now, if you're watering your garden with compost tea, I do recommend that you water your garden with plain water first. And what that's going to do is it's going to moisten the soil. And as you know, a moist sponge will soak up water a lot better than a bone dry sponge. Sometimes when you pour water over the garden, you can just see it like kind of flooding away, and it almost repels the water. So what you want to do is you want to give your garden a light watering, and that way it pre-moistens the soil, and then the compost tea can soak in a lot easier. Because you don't want it running away from the plants, you want it around the plants. And this is how I do it. Just a little bit here and there. Make sure that each plant gets some. And boy, your plants will definitely thank you. Make sure you get it nice and low too. You don't want to do it way up high, because what that's going to do, it's going to dig down and disturb the roots. Take it down low and just let it gently flow around the plants. This weird mystery plant here is really loving the compost tea. Ever since I started feeding these plants, they've been going nuts. These are the Kelsey onions, and they're really starting to get a nice wide base on them. It's great. The benefits of compost tea are so amazing, yet the downsides are none. There are no downsides. And there are downsides to almost everything in life. You know how I'm always harping about the balance. The thing with compost tea is there is no downside to it at all. It's cheap. You can buy a bag of compost and manure or compost at any store, any like Walmart or Lowe's or any big box store, even any hardware store, any garden center. And it's so inexpensive and it lasts forever. I mean, if you don't use it all, just roll up the bag, throw it in your shed, use it next year. It's not going to go bad. The compost tea doesn't go bad. Even if you leave it in there for a week or so and it reeks, it's okay. You still pour it on the soil, and the beneficial bacteria are going to take over the anaerobic bacteria. It's not going to hurt it at all. By the way, whereas some folks will make the brewed compost tea and they say spray it all over your plants, this is not a foliar spray. So don't confuse this with the brewed compost tea. They are not the same thing at all. It's like comparing cats and oranges. They're not the same thing at all. But there are no downsides to this. You can't over-fertilize with this. If you pour in more than you need, the soil is going to just hold on to that and use it as it needs it. That's the cool thing. The bacteria will only use what they need and then produce food for the plants. So it's a steady supply of food for your plants. And it's cheap. It's easy to use. I mean, all you do is you throw in a handful, you add some water. I mean, come on. There is no weird measuring. If you add too much compost, that's okay. Your plants are going to love you anyway. So use this. Each time you want to fertilize your plants, like for instance, if your plants are looking a little bit peaked and stuff, use this each time instead of plain water until your plants are looking nice and healthy like this. Then you use them every third watering for a maintenance all year round. And that's all you have to do. It's so simple to use, so functional for your garden. I just can't, if people ask me, Ray, how do I do this? Ray, what kind of fertilizer would you recommend for this? I don't recommend any fertilizers. I've used, back in the day when I first started, I used Miracle-Gro. And then I got off Miracle-Gro and I started experimenting with all kinds of other organic fertilizers. And there is a fertilizer for every day of the week, for every occasion. There's always some snake oil salesman out there trying to sell the next greatest thing in fertilizer. And the thing is that your soil doesn't need any of that garbage. You don't need to mix all this weird stuff up and throw it into your soil. That's not necessary. All you have to do, your soil is doing just fine. All you have to do is feed it. Feed your soil and then kick back and enjoy your day. You don't have to overthink this, okay? Plants don't overthink this. We don't have to overthink this. So don't worry about all the weird stuff that you have to add to your soil. Don't worry about it at all. Compost tea is great. It's not going to change the pH of your soil. It's not going to change anything to your soil. It's just going to feed your soil. So your soil can feed your plants and your plants are going to feed you. Everybody's having a good day. Now, that being said, when you do feed your... He's sitting there just looking at me. I wonder if you guys can see him. He just looks at me sometimes. He's like my best... You're my best audience. Yes, you are. But you're wet. I'm not going to hold you. But remember, when you feed your garden, you're feeding your plants, but you're also feeding your weeds. So be sure you get in there and you pull your weeds, because let me tell you something. This will supercharge your plants. This will definitely get your plants going really good. That's a good thing. But on the flip side, the balance of this is it's also going to do the same thing for your weeds. And your weeds have an advantage. They know how to grow. These plants that we grow in our garden, very few of them exist in nature the way that we see them in our garden, because we've changed them through hybridization from growing and producing and stuff. I mean, tomato plants don't look like this out in nature. They don't, because these have been tamed from the wild ones. Same thing with the sunflowers and every other thing that we grow. Whereas weeds, they haven't been changed. They are in their wild environment, and wild things have the advantage over domesticated things any day of the week. So you have weeds in your garden, and I've been asked, and I mentioned this in the other episode, Ray, how do I get my weeds out of my garden? Use these things is what you do. Get in there and do the work. And that's what I promote. I know that it just sounds kind of rough, but I actually practice what I preach. And you remember the original garden from last year? Remember I had that regular in-ground garden? That was where there used to be a pasture, and it was overgrown with weeds. And one of the first episodes of the year, if you go back into last year's episodes, you'll see that area. And there was junk there, and I was moving this box, and there was weeds up to my waist. And I got out there and I pulled those weeds by hand. Oh, it was awful. And then I used a rototiller. And I tilled up the soil for the first time, because you got to do that to get the compost in there. And then I planted my garden. I had a really great garden. Well, this year, the only thing I planted in there was corn and some pumpkins and some watermelons. And I got kind of lazy. Yeah, I did. We do that every now and then. I got kind of lazy and I didn't weed the garden. I thought, oh, I'll do it tomorrow. And then it rained. And then I said, oh, I'll do it next week. Well, what happened is that I got this. I'm going to show you a picture, okay? This is what I got from being lazy. That's really sad. And it's kind of like Where's Waldo. You can't find the corn in there. And the thing is that it crowded out the corn. So the corn was growing, but it just can't compete with nature. So what happened is it just got crowded out. So then I got out there. I got my gloves on. And normally I don't weed with gloves. I just do it with my hands. But there was just way too much. And I got out there in that whole area one day. I spent a whole day out there, and I sweated. I sweated more than I ever did in my life. And I was pulling out weeds one at a time all throughout the day. And I took breaks, but I got out there, and I did the whole garden. And this is what I came up with when I was done. That's a lot of work. Yep. I got out there with my gloves and I was pulling those weeds out. And let me tell you something. There are muscles that you have that you don't even realize you have until you use them a little bit too much. For the next 3 days, the backs of my legs and my butt, they hurt so bad it was hard to bend over. So tying my shoes and doing anything that concerned bending over was really kind of... I hate to say it, a pain in the butt. It was awful. But that's the price I paid. Because you know what? If you want to be lazy, you're going to pay for it one way or the other. I should have been pulling those weeds when they were small and they come out really easy. But I didn't do it. So yeah, I paid the price. So what I did with those weeds is... Actually, let me show you what I did with those weeds. Come on over here. Well, I left the perimeter because what I thought, and this is my way of thinking, is that the perimeter has weeds around it, and what that's going to do is it's going to form a rudimentary windbreak, because you remember I told you the wind's just whipped right through here. And so I left that up there, and it's been doing pretty good. It kind of breaks the wind from coming in here. And these weeds, oh Lord, what a mess. Yep, I was pulling these weeds out, and as you can see, well, there. Now as you can see, they have this root ball on them. And so when you pull your weeds when they're small, you get the weeds out. But when you wait till they're larger, you're going to be putting up with this. And you're going to have the dirt. And that kind of sucks. But what I did is I just laid them all sideways like this, all around the garden. And I have watermelons over here. I have Moon and Stars watermelon, which are a beautiful watermelon that's sweet. And I have that over there too. But right here, I have my sugar pumpkins. Yep, my sugar pumpkins. And they are doing phenomenally well. And I had germinated. Remember, I germinated the Atlantic Giant. I think it was Atlantic Giant pumpkin. And what happened was is that I planted them out here. They sprouted, and then they just died. They just rotted away in the soil. Felt kind of bad. I only had two seeds, and they died. So that sucked. That kind of sucked. But they were just a novelty anyway. So what I hurried up and did is I planted some sugar pumpkin seeds that I've been saving for a couple years. I grew sugar pumpkin. It's really loud over here today, but I planted the sugar pumpkin seeds here, and I love sugar pumpkins. Sugar pumpkins are great for like pies, cookies, breads, everything. And I take them, I bake them off, and I take the stuff and the goo or whatever that the flesh, and I put it into Ziplocs, and I use that for years. I use it for years from my last sugar pumpkins, and I ran out this year. I had it for 2 years. I ran out, so I need new ones. Hey, Rascal, come on over here. He's wet. Yep. He's like a sponge. He goes through the garden. He just soaks up all the moisture, and then he wants to sit on my lap. Yeah, what a pig. But anyway, I'm definitely going to have good pumpkins and good watermelons. I have Moon and Stars watermelons over here, Moon and Stars watermelons over there. And what they're going to do is grow over this decomposing mat of vegetation, and it's going to... Mosquitoes are starting to wake up. It's going to keep the weeds down long enough for these things to grow over. Nothing is perfect for keeping weeds down unless, of course, you have the super thick layer of mulch, which I don't have. And I'm not going to go out and buy shredded bark or anything for mulch. This is my way of making my own mulch. I pull the weeds, put them to use. They're going to break down. And then this will be the last time I use this garden space. At the end of this garden year, I'm going to take the fence off around here and add it on to the goat's pen and make it an even bigger goat's pen. Each year, I'm going to make their pen bigger and bigger so they have more and more room. And also, with all this dirt and all these weeds and all the worms that are in here, chickens are going to love it. So it's going to be a bonus for them. And I'm going to scale back to just having the raised beds because I prefer raised beds to regular in-ground gardening. But this is the result of compost tea. I wanted to show you the weeds that I pulled out here because I really paid my dues for being lazy. And that's just what happens. But the compost tea is definitely doing good for this. As for the corn, I have about maybe 6 plants and they look kind of crappy, but you know what? I deserved it. I deserved it because I neglected my corn and I didn't take care of it. So I'm just gonna have to buy my sweet corn at the grocery store this year. I think I can handle that okay. Anyway, I think we're pretty much done here. I just wanted to discuss using compost tea in your garden, and also make sure you get out there right now. I know it sucks, it's really kind of hot, but do it in the morning or do it in the evening. Get out there and pull the weeds. And also one last tip for you, this will definitely help you out to keep your garden alive and growing. When you water your garden, make sure you do it. I know a lot of you have jobs, you know, you're real human beings, you have real jobs and responsibilities. And I live a lifestyle that's really not exactly what you do, because you get up, you go to work, and you're thinking, well, I can't do all that stuff, and I understand that. So what I would recommend is when you water your garden, you can't do it in the morning. You got to get up, you got to eat, you got to get dressed, you got to take a shower. He's looking around like, what are you talking to? And you got to get the kids off to school. You have a life. You don't have time to stand out there with a hose watering your garden. And I don't like drip irrigation. I just never did like that because it just does the surface watering. And I water deep. So what you want to do is later on in the evening after dinner, when you have a little bit of extra time, get out there, saturate your garden, get it a good solid soaking way down deep. And that's when you use the compost tea as well. Get it way down deep. And that way your plants will last through the next day during the heat of the day, because this is the really hard part of the growing season. This is the hottest time of the year. And what's going to happen? You're going to notice on, like, say, your watermelons and your pumpkins, during the middle of the day, their leaves are just going to wilt. They look like wet tissue. Don't worry. Don't water your plants when that happens. This is what they do to avoid the heat of the day. Their leaves are different than any other plant leaves. They use water pressure, water in their leaves to hold them up. So when the heat of the day comes, they let the pressure down, the leaves wilt, and that keeps them from pointing up towards the sun and just boiling themselves to death. It's a protective measure for these plants, so don't worry about it. Water your plants in the evening, give them a good solid soaking, it'll get them through the next day, and then you're all set to go. That's my final tip for you. I hope your garden's doing okay. Mine's doing good. I have some good things, I have some bad things, and it's a good average year for me, because if it were a perfect year, I would be a little bit suspicious. I don't like perfection, because perfection shouldn't be had anywhere here on earth, okay? So I'm having some successes, I'm having some failures, and so I'm learning some stuff, and I'm enjoying the heck out of myself, and I hope you are too. Next week, I'll see you. Until then, this is Ray in the Garden. Have a great day, everybody. Bye. I lost my sponge. Okay.